everybody. I'm Colleen.
I'm Natasha, and we're here with
The Girl and the Dream Catcher.
We said that so cool.
And that was so insane. That's amazing.
I didn't say it, so.
Sorry, I'll work on it next time. We're so excited about your EP that's coming out, so we'd love for you to tell everybody all about it.
Okay, we would love that too. So, all about it. There's 6 songs on it. What if I was like, there's 3 songs that you've already heard?
It's a 1-song EP.
It's definitely, this got some stuff on it that you've heard a little bit. Some of our singles are on it, but it's got a lot of stuff that you haven't heard yet. I think it's a fantastic representation of the kind of stuff that we're going to be doing going on out. The stuff that you're going to hear, though, is like, I honestly think it's very different from the stuff that we've released so far.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, we've said before, and we'll say again, that it's a really amazing endeavor and experience being a songwriter, especially in kind of contemporary pop now, and especially sort of in the position that we're in currently. You release a single, you see how people respond. Based on their response, you write another song, you release another single, and you sort of morph and change based on what people say, and you're granted certain permissions based
on... And how you feel, too.
Well, of course.
What do you want?
So you sort of morph and adapt, based on how we grow and how people respond. And so, you know, the different, like I said, permissions that are being granted to us by the amazing fans and you know, people saying more, you know, it has sort of come to a head with negatives in that, you know, we really sort of dared to go there with this body of work. And we're really, really excited.
We're stoked.
To sort of hand the reins over to the fans, just be like, what do you think?
Yes. Yeah. Cool. Is there like, well, 2 questions. I always ask like 5 questions in one, and it's weird.
I'm
gonna ramble, but I guess first things first, what is there one song that's like most personal to you guys that you love the most, that you just are so excited for fans to hear? And secondly, on top of that, in terms of the writing process, and like, and you'll have to repeat the question to me when I finish.
Okay.
In terms of the writing process and production process, like, how do the songs come together for you guys? Like, is one of you like, oh my god, I have this great idea, or I want you to hear this hook, or like anything like that?
Okay.
What was the first
question? I need to meditate on this. So, okay. Yeah, actually, what was
song? Song that's most personal.
I mean...
It's so hard.
See, when I hear personal, I sort of think most vulnerable, because all of the songs are very personal, because we did write all of them.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. A lot of artists... Not... This is, like, trash talk.
No, it's true. By the way, it's true. I'll say it. Like, the majority of artists, particularly artists that are, like, your age, they're either not writing the songs or they're working with like 7 or 8 songwriters.
Yeah.
Right. You know, so the fact that you guys like...
It's very rare to find like entirely written songs by the artist.
Right. We do have some songs on there that had 1 or 2 co-writers on them, but a lot of it is...
It was us. We are the co-writers.
Yeah, you guys are the co-writers. I hear most vulnerable in that, and I would say the most like vulnerable is Monster, probably, especially because we have a sort of a set style. We were blessed super early on with finding our sound, which is rare for any artist. I think a lot of artists sort of have like a journey to finding. I mean,
absolutely.
Justin Bieber came out like
a few hours.
2 years ago and was like, I just found my sound.
I
got so nervous when that happened. I was like, oh no, oh my god, I'm not gonna find my sound forever. And then especially when we joined up, it was like, how are we gonna make 2 people who don't even know their sound yet find a sound together?
And gel. Yeah.
Right. And so we were very blessed to establish a sound and feel very comfortable in our sound really early on. You just got really cute. Sometimes he gets cute.
Just got cute.
Yeah,
just found our sound. Oh, I just got
breaking.
Cute.
He just got cute.
But Monster is actually a departure from our sound.
Okay.
And so it's the most different you've ever heard from us. And actually, even though it's not a very highly impressive song vocally, you know, like everybody wants like trills and
speak for yourself. I'm like skrelting on that.
That's true. But it's it's something that's really difficult to perform live because of the really soft intricateness of the vocals and matching the harmonies, and so we hardly ever perform it live, and so not a lot of people have heard it, and so we're really excited about that one.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna make things complicated. Monster came about because we were actually trying to get it, we were trying to sync it into a movie that we were in, so we sort of wrote it roughly around the paradigms of the characters that we were playing, and so while, I mean, you know, obviously, like, even when you play a character, you put a lot of yourself into that character. So even though we were writing it about these characters, we were putting a lot of ourselves and our relationship into the song. There was still that sort of thing that was going on. What?
I'm imagining people, I'm glad you're saying this, because I'm imagining people listening to the lyrics and being like, this is your most personal one? Sorry, it's like, it's a little bit like, because the characters were dark, and so the song is dark, and I don't want people to think it's about us.
Okay.
But I'm glad he's saying this.
And so, for me, you know, a lot of people ask, like, what's your favorite song? What was the hardest? But, like, the most, like, personal song for me, I think, is Cry Wolf. Because we really, that is one of the more negatively connotated songs on the EP, but that one is like all us. That is very like bare bones, writing about a very specific dark period in our relationship. And you know, and it's also sort of thematically tied in with sort of a problem that I think a lot of like young couples go through, in that
intense personality young couples,
amen,
especially
in that kind of like,
especially in the public eye.
And there's like a lot of like pressure that was on us, and there was I don't know, it was a very personal experience to write that song, and just and a lot of the times when we, you know, are working with a producer or a co-writer, they say like, oh, you guys are like, you know, hashtag relationship goals, like, you know, Disney bubblegum, like, let's write a happy song about
and
love,
like,
and
yeah,
that,
yeah.
And that was the first time where we got in a session and people were like, okay, let's like write something darker that's like really about you, and that was a really personal experience for us.
And also I would say, like, something that has always been a huge theme in my life, like, if life is book, theme of my book is always like, for every darkness there is a light response, and I've had a lot of darkness in my life, which is not anything that I'm uncomfortable with or uncomfortable sharing, because I truly believe that everything has an answer, and everything has like a, you know, for every action equal opposite.
Absolutely. We're actually just talking that before like, you know, it's like when you go through really dark times and really negative times, for everybody who's watching us, when you go through that and you are a survivor and you stand up and say, I'm going to get through this, it makes the really positive moments so much sweeter.
Definitely.
You know what I mean?
Well, right. And also, like, it just, you can't see the beauty of the light without knowing the context of the dark.
Absolutely.
And that's, I mean, that's a theme in everybody's life, but that's especially been something that I'm only not speaking for you because I feel as though I shouldn't speak for you in this circumstance, but that is something that is so prevalent in the theme of my life. And
in the theme of our relationship.
Yeah, aka like just theme of everything. Mm-hmm. That's just like a huge life lesson. And so it's really rewarding to explore the darker stuff, because everybody's also really uncomfortable to talk about it.
Totally. Yeah, that's what we were just talking about too, is especially in this world of like teen media, especially, it's really, really hard to talk about something without it being labeled as inappropriate or like,
oh my
too
God,
dark
these
for
days?
Kids.
Yes.
Yes, yeah. It's too hard. And so, I mean, I think it's really important, in our last interview we were talking about this, and I applaud you guys for bringing it out, because people that talk to kids are so afraid of talking to them about it, but they understand it and they need to understand it. And it's, I mean, if anybody's gonna talk to them about it, it might as well be someone who like, talk to kids on a normal basis, you know,
in their
media. So I think that's awesome that you guys are doing that.
Yeah. I actually think keeping people, and obviously, like, you know, I'm not a parent yet, but like, and like, I plan to not be for like 400 years.
that's a good age.
400 years.
No, but like, I, you know, I'm still a kid myself, but I truly believe, just like being a kid myself and knowing how I was raised and being around children all the time, I truly believe one of the worst things you can do for a kid or a person is to shelter them immensely.
Absolutely.
Because
absolutely.
I would have been incapable of living my life.
And even now, like, with, you know, it's like, with social media and with, like, everyone has the internet. Like, parents can't protect their kids and pretend that it's, like, the white picket fence in life. Because that's not, like, the world that we live in.
Yeah, absolutely. But what's cool is that we do have, you know, like, role models that... Because you guys are the ones that the kids listen to. When you have an idol and that's your, like,
number
one...
Well, they also listen to us a lot.
True, they do listen to us.
They listen to us more.
But, like, on some level, I mean, your idol is your everything. And whatever they say goes. And, like, that's the word you live by. So to have people that are in a relation, in a position of being an idol, it's awesome to see you guys, you know, talking about it.
Well, and that's a huge thing that we sort of stumbled upon by accident, but have really, like, stuck to in particular with this band. We really feel like we have a big responsibility as a pop duo that sort of not revolves around but very heavily features the fact that we are in a relationship, a very public relationship. You know, it's almost like a duty to speak to that in the sense of, like, and I'm not, I've said this a million times, I'm not knocking, like, the single life. I'm not knocking sort of the fast pace of that, but, like,
I am.
There's a lot of sort of thematically in music and in media and on TV and in movies of, like, the bumping single life and, like, you know, I don't know, like, sleeping around and, like, all this stuff. And, like, we really feel strongly that we have a responsibility to bring a relationship into the life and sort of, or into the light, and sort of make a relationship being sexy again and really talk about, to your point, like, the ebbs and flows of a relationship, the ups and downs of it, like, that's real. I think a lot of people, like I said before, look at us and see, like, oh, you know, bubblegum Disney star,
hashtag,
you know,
relationship goals.
And it's like, it's like, okay, like, thank you, that's really sweet, but, like, we go through it. We get in yelling matches. We cry together. Like, you
know, the idea is just not to perpetuate a false idea.
Absolutely. I mean, talking about, like, what it really means, like, to be in a relationship.
And on that note, too, like, with social media, like, you know, Natasha and I, we were teen magazine editors for a long time, and we noticed with the advent of social media, like, how much pressure kids put on themselves to, like, show this perfect life or get this certain amount of likes.
Have a boyfriend and have...
You know, and what we really love about you guys is that you use your platform to, like, inspire others and create a positive change, and that's important. Yeah. Note, too, like, with social media, like, you know, Natasha and I, we were teen magazine editors for a long time, and we noticed with the advent of social media, like, how much pressure kids put on themselves to, like, show this perfect life or get this certain amount of likes.
Have a boyfriend and have...
You know, and what we really love about you guys is that you use your platform to, like, inspire others and create a positive change, and that's important. So I don't know if you want to speak a little bit just about sort of not getting caught up, and we touched upon it a little bit when we met over the weekend at the Celebrity Expo, I think it was called.
Experience.
I was close. But if you guys want to speak just sort of a little bit about kind of, you know, that social media numbers doesn't define you and what's really important and stuff like that.
I sort of feel like, I was about to be like, we missed that generation, but we didn't at all. We are that generation. Just speaking personally, I get overwhelmed sometimes. Like, so I go through phases where I'm like, social media is the best! And I'm like, and I live my life through it. But then all of a sudden I'll just get like, oh, I can't do this anymore. Right. Like, just all of a sudden, like, I touch the hot stove and then I have to, like, take a break for a few days or be like, hey guys, I need a minute. Because it's just... It's almost like Pokemon Go. You know, it's like you're living in this alternate reality, and it's like the most fun, and you're like, oh, he's got a, you know, Snorlax.
Right,
or whatever.
Yeah.
Did you?
No, I didn't. But I caught a lot of Sandshrews. A lot of Sandshrews around here. I'm not going to say where we are. Because, you know, those are rare. Just kidding. These are bad Pokemon jokes. Okay.
We're in Ohio.
Yeah.
It's really cool here. There's great views.
I know. They're like, where are all those Snorlax?
Yeah.
Social media can sort of be like Pokemon Go. Like, it's, like, really fantastic, and then you realize, like, whoa, this isn't real life.
Yeah.
And it's, for me at least, it kind of happens all at once like that, where I'm like, I have taken one step too far into this, and it's sort of like a departure. Like, you have to take sort of like a break. You have to take, it's like an addiction almost. Mm-hmm, like, you have to really step out, and then you're sort of like, oh my God, there's everything around me, and this is happening all the time.
Yeah. Like, I also feel like for you guys, like, you know, being, you know, having millions of followers or whatever it is, it's almost like you want to be there for your fans and stuff,
all
which you're
the time.
Awesome at. But at the same time, there's probably moments where you're like, wait, I want to have, like, my life a little bit. You know what I'm saying?
Like, well, and the sad reality of it, but the reality that we have to remind each other and ourselves of all the time is you can constantly perpetuate positivity. You can constantly remind people to be their best selves on the internet. You're never going to be able to reach every single person and tell them that.
Yeah.
And it's a really dangerous cipher that we have entered in on constant occasions where we're just sort of like, wow, take a step back, don't do that. But it's definitely something that I see kids and adults do on social media all the time. This debate that happens, this sort of like getting in there and being vicious and being really confident behind the keys of the message board, or really confident behind your tweets, that, you know, these faceless things.
Especially
that you can
when
just
your
send
name
out
and your picture is something that's like random and not
absolutely
even you.
Absolutely. And well, and even if it is you, it's like you can sort of say whatever you want and there's virtually no consequence because it's not like someone can like come at you.
Absolutely.
Like they and if they tweet
your
something
knock at the door.
If they tweet
just me at your door. Hello.
But if
hello.
If they tweet
fan 9971.
If they tweet something at you that you don't like, you can block them, which is not how it works in real life.
Yeah,
and so
right.
it does. It perpetuates this reality that well, isn't real.
Yes.
And yeah, I do. I see it constantly of just, you know, and you try, and even when you're trying to uplift someone, you know, if someone is sort of mouthing off negatively and you try to uplift them, hey, please don't do that, it's really easy for them to just sort of mouth off again.
Right,
and
yeah.
So their social media, I truly believe, is a beautiful thing because there are so many people that we get to talk to, get to interact with, get to uplift, get to change their lives. And that's a really fantastic thing. At the same time, it's sort of a Pandora's box. It's a double-edged sword because there's always going to be that negativity thing. And I think that's a great lesson to sort of learn about life, you know, in that you can be the best version of yourself, but that's kind of where the buck stops.
Mm-hmm.
You can be the best version of yourself online. People are still going to mouth off on you if they want to, and you can't necessarily change that.
Sure.
So at the end of the day, you can only really be the best version of yourself, and what everyone else does is up to them.
Right, which also, to answer your original question, which is, we were like, social media!
No, but I love that. I love this kind of conversation.
Mm-hmm. The numbers, yeah. And I had a man in my life who was very involved in my career early on, where I was getting a lot of hate. You know, it's like so funny. Hate is so weird because it will be really intense, and it'll be from people who call themselves your fans.
Yeah.
And then I'll like come home to Ryan, or I'll like call my mom, and I'll be like, I'm so sad. Like, all my fans hate me. And she's like, no, like, it's not. Well, A, those people are not like really true fans.
Yeah.
But, also B, it's like, it ebbs and flows so quickly. Like, you don't really have to do much to make them unhappy, and you don't really have to do much to make them really happy.
Right. Sure.
And so you have to sort of depart from that because it really has nothing to do with you.
Yeah.
But like, I gain so much from the fan interaction, and that has nothing to do with numbers for me. Like, just like the genuine interaction, like when people genuinely ask me questions.
Yeah, and a connection with somebody.
Exactly. And so it's like I could have 100 followers or 100 million followers, and that wouldn't matter to me. But that's me. Like, I'm not an 11-year-old girl, and I do feel like it's gone even far beyond celebrity, and I think it goes into just like. I watched something, I'm always on the internet, but I watched something the other day where it was like it was a collection of normal people with huge followings on Instagram.
Okay.
And like normal as in just sort of, you know, like a college student,
right, sure.
or you know,
not an actress, singer.
Right, right. Just huge followings because of social media.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And they go on to talk about how much of it of their lives it affects and how much of their time they spend doing it, and how some people seem to have a really good handle on it. They're like, it's just really fun, and I don't know, I have a bunch of followers.
Yeah.
And some people seem to be, well, actually the video itself was focusing on like what kind of a toll it can take on
you. Yeah.
And I always want to like jump through my computer screen and hug all of these people who seem to care so much about, like it's sort of like we as a society have been like, your worth is your number.
Mm-hmm.
And it's such a psychotic thing. It's like, that has nothing to do with anything. It's sort of like time is a made-up concept, like time is a human concept. Absolutely. It's like social media is not a real thing. Mm-hmm. And it makes me so sad to think that all of these wonderful, beautiful people who, like, I could have played soccer with when I was in middle school, or like these people that I imagine in my head and who they are, it's like I want to hug them and hold them, because it, social media makes so many people so sad sometimes.
Yeah.
And especially on the topic of numbers.
Mm-hmm. Well, like, and I'm really glad that you said that, and I wish that I came up with this, but I'm totally taking this from a fantastic documentary, Happy. Have you seen it?
Yeah, I love that one.
It's amazing. You must watch it. It changed my life.
It's on Netflix.
On Netflix. and it's I'm really glad that you brought up like the sadness, because I think social media especially plays a role in creating this false notion of what happiness is.
Mm-hmm.
In that, and again, totally barring this, I'm not this smart, in that we as a society think that happiness comes from popularity.
Mm-hmm.
And it actually is very, very starkly proven that unhappiness can come from popularity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure.
Happiness comes from meaningful relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And meaningful relationships, while they can maybe start, or while they can you know, effervesce in a way online, meaningful relationships can never be sustained online.
True.
And a large following, a large fan base, you can't have meaningful relationship with 7 million people.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
you can try and you can
try to, you know, build up those followers and build up those followers and build up those followers. But the fact of the matter is, the meaningful relationships, the people you see in your life, your parents, your friends, those are the people who are going to make you happy.
Mm-hmm.
And the correlation that if I just get 1,000 followers, or if I just get 5,000 followers, if I just get 1,000,000 followers, then I'll be happy. It's not true.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because you never want that many, too. Once you get that, then you want more and more, and it never...
Yeah, but then also, it's like, let's say you get 1,000,000 followers, then what? What
then
does that
exactly
mean?
It's, again, it's like, it's sort of a false idol.
Absolutely.
You know, it's not where happiness is truly going to stem from. Again, I'm not condemning social media. I think it's a beautiful thing if it's used for the right reasons.
Yes, absolutely.
But
it's just about a healthy relationship with it.
Exactly.
Well, and also, and then we'll totally be done talking about this, because you have two people
in
the room.
But this is like really important, though, and I'm glad we're having this, because I feel like not enough people, you know, especially in your position, open up and talk about this stuff, because it really is an issue that everyone deals with, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's the world we live in today.
Yeah, absolutely.
I personally get, and I tend to not read, like, I don't, like, just go through my Twitter, because it makes me sad. Like, I see so much love, and I feel that love genuinely, because how incredible is it that you can have this relationship with these people who you've never met before? I just think that that's one of the most gorgeous things in the world. Mm. And so, like, the idea of fans is just like, I mean, the word is, I can still sort of not get past the word. It's like, but it's like relationships with these people. You share common interests. You like each other. It's like, there's just, it's just love. It's just love. If it's real, it's just love.
Yeah.
And I love that. but I'm sometimes made very sad by the things that I see, because, you know, you don't really get a full idea of who these people are, who I am, who he is, who, you know, whoever is.
140 characters.
Right, exactly. Yeah. You don't really get a real idea from anything, from interviews. You just, like, you have to really know them. And so I get a lot of judgment passed on me, as a lot of people do who are in the spotlight.
Or just in general.
In general. But I get a lot of judgment passed on me, and so I tend to not read. But, like, I was gonna make a really interesting point, and now I suck. I really love to talk to my fans, and I really love all of that, but I get a lot of hate specifically for not spending enough time on social media.
That's the thing, you know what I mean? Like,
right,
there's never enough time.
And you also have to take care of yourself. You can't spend all that time, you know, like, you're a person.
Right, well, also, it's like, you wouldn't have anybody left at the end of the day to talk to if I was spending all my time on social media, because it takes a lot longer than you think it does.
Well, and that's what I was saying before. It's the double-edged sword thing. Mm-hmm. The relationship that we get to have with our fans is so, so, so valuable to us. And the fact of the matter is that sort of false idol idea that, you know, I just suggested, it's like, if you think that, you know, this sort of social media image, who isn't really us, it's just these snippets that we get to put out, if you know, if you think that that's, you know, gonna this is a bad way of putting it, because we really are there for our fans. But at the end of the day, like, if you think that that's gonna, like, be there for you, and if you go on, it's like, where are you? Like, I need you. It's like, well, you know, we're humans too in the world,
sure,
and we're all humans in the world.
Absolutely.
And this actually isn't really a celebrity issue. It's more of an internet issue.
Right.
Yeah.
You know.
Absolutely.
But that's how I was gonna tie it all in. I was gonna say that, like, I get a lot of hate for not spending enough time on social media, but it's because the time that I do spend on social media, and I'm, like, speaking directly to the Twittersphere right now, but the time that I do spend, I don't waste it on negativity, I don't waste it on responding to people who are negative. I only ever am talking to my fans and talking to these people that I really do consider, like, my virtual friends.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, I take enough time for myself so that at the end of the day I have enough love to spread with you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Because anything else, it's not worth it. You don't want me when I'm not me, and you also don't want me to interact with hate. It's like, I believe in a healthy balance, and
Absolutely. And with all that being said, like, I've seen your relationships with your Twitter, with your fans on Twitter, and it's so adorable.
I love my fans, and
they really love you, and, like, it's great to have that understanding, and I want to thank you guys again for this conversation.
Yeah.
Like, that was awesome.
And then we'll be done.
Yeah.
So that was great. No.
Yeah.
Bye, guys.
We actually have a few cool fan questions, so
yeah,
we'll get
to sure.
that
too. Yeah, for sure. Let's go to that. Some fan questions.
Thank you guys for sending them in. I like this one. Kaylee Ann wants to know what your favorite Disneyland ride is.
Space Mountain, I think, for me.
It's a good one. It's a really good one. It's really fun.
I cannot choose. I love Disneyland.
I know,
so
it's
much.
Awesome.
Although Disney World, what's the Yeti one?
Oh, wait,
in Adventureland? No, in...
We've only been at Disney World once. But there's, like, the big, gigantic mountain one with
Splash
the Yeti.
Oh!
And then you go backwards.
Mount Everest.
Mount Everest, something like that.
Like,
Everest Adventure, yes.
Yeah,
at the very end. It's
yes,
super scary.
My dad wouldn't go on that with me, so I had to single rider it, but I got to go, like, three times.
Yeah.
Single rider is the way to go. Okay, this is another good one. What's your favorite kind of frozen yogurt? Good flavors?
Or if you go to, like, a Pinkberry type joint,
what
toppings are involved in your creation?
Yeah.
I like green tea or pistachio.
I'm a pistachio with rainbow sprinkles kind of girl.
I don't like toppings, so I'm just straight up, like, regular Pinkberry and nothing else.
I'm a type 1 diabetic, so I stay at home.
He never
I'm such a bummer. It's like, what's your favorite sugary snack? It's like, water.
Your favorite sugary snack. Cheetos.
And then here, this is a great one too. Sarah wants to know if you could collaborate with any other artist. Who would you want to work with?
Macklemore, Disclosure, Chainsmokers,
Ellie Goulding.
Flume is really good.
We literally, like, we might as well have a list in our pocket.
Yeah.
We're very into, it's like, this is getting hippy-dippy for a second, but we're really, like, into, like, manifesting, you know, like, manifest destiny, like,
yes,
the thoughts become things, the things in your
love
life.
Love that.
It always works, y'all.
It always works.
It really does.
I manifested her.
Tell the story.
And then I want to tell the story of how it works.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Why?
Your thing.
Oh, right. I stopped telling the story because we just have so many stories. We do.
But I want to answer the question, though. What did you just ask? There was something about thoughts become things, about manifesting.
Frozen yogurt. No, I'm totally
kidding. I think I asked about frozen yogurt.
You were talking about Flume and the different artists that influenced you.
Oh,
and
yes,
how you believe in manifesting.
Yeah.
So that was it. I already made the point. We're like constantly, like, thinking about, like, who we want to manifest into our lives in these collaborations.
Right.
So I'm super into, like, The Secret. Like,
yes.
Yeah.
If I can't go to sleep, I'll just have it on in the background and, like, let it go into my brain. So
I had a friend who would always be like, just secreted that.
That's really good. I'm going to start using
just
that.
Secret.
But a
That's
couple
really
months
good.
Before Natasha and I decided to embark on this and start YSB Now, I was on a phone with a friend of mine. I normally live in New Jersey. I'm bummed I'm not going to be there for your concert.
No.
We actually went to R5 at the Balloon
the
Festival.
Balloon Festival.
So I want to ask
so
you
much
some
fun.
Questions about balloons. But anyway, a friend of mine called and was like, so, like, what do you see happening for yourself? And I was like, I'd love to, like, spend half my time in LA and half the time in, like, New Jersey and, like, start a really cool thing. And then, like, I forgot about the conversation. Like, 3 months later, all this starts happening and my friend's like, Colleen, do you not remember that phone conversation on that random Saturday morning? And I'm like, oh, yo, that worked. Oh my God.
Yeah.
You secreted that.
I secreted that.
So my question is, you guys are performing at this hot air balloon festival. Have you ever been in a hot air balloon?
No, but we're full of hot air.
Hey!
We're not really. I just just needed to take that, because otherwise I would have been mad.
And so your name is the girl on the Dreamcatcher, and I know you guys have been doing a ton of press, so I hope that it's not an annoying question, but do you have any, like, weird recurring dreams?
Yes!
Okay, I want to hear about weird recurring dreams.
Okay, so I have two, both of which you're going to be like, what's going on in mine? So one of them is I'm always in this weird little shack, which, like, I've spent a lot of time traveling. Most of my childhood was traveling, and so I stayed in a variation of places for a long period of time.
It took me this long to realize that you said time traveling.
Me too. I was just like,
time traveling.
You spent a lot of time. I did a lot of time traveling. I just secreted that.
It's actually 2064 right now, and we just came back in time.
We look great.
Yeah. But social media didn't change.
Yeah, social media is the same.
You're so beautiful now in 2064.
They have 7 albums out right now.
Yeah. So, end of the year 3000.
So you're in a shack.
I was about to make a Jonas Brothers joke.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Not much has changed. So I'm in a shack, and it's like this little shack of a house for like eating cereal at the kitchen table. Very like World War Z. And like the news is on, and like this tiny little, like, you know how like TVs used to go back really far?
Yeah.
And they were like little, and the news is on, and my parents are like making breakfast, and it's my whole family, even though we haven't lived together forever. And it's like, in other news, a tsunami is coming. And I'm like, what? And I look out my window, literally like to my right, and the newscaster is like still talking, but this like 500-foot tsunami is just like,
oh my gosh.
And I'm always, and it happens, and I'm like underwater, and I'm like, no. And then like I get to the top, and there's all these boxes, and like that's my dream. Oh my,
not much has changed, like, but you do live underwater.
But I live underwater!
Yes! But have you gotten to the point where as you're dreaming that, in your dream, you're sort of like,
this is a dream?
I know this is a dream.
No.
Not yet?
Never.
Me either.
Which I'm sure, like, is like my stress overtaking me. Maybe. Or like something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like all of my priorities.
Yeah.
What about you, any good recurring dreams from like when you were a kid or like recently, or weird dreams or random dreams?
Not really. I was in college for like a minute, and I ended up dropping out for a whole myriad of reasons. It's a very long story, but I was.
That's on next week's live stream.
Yeah. Why Ryan dropped out of college? I wasn't smart enough.
That's not true.
I was in an acting company of 20 kids, and I totally believe in the program. I mean, I don't wish that I stuck it out because I'm really happy with how my life worked, but like I totally believe in the program, nothing but love for it. And I have constant recurring dreams. They're not very like vivid or anything like esoteric or whatever, but constant recurring dreams about like return. If you leave the company, you can't come back in. You have to like start all over. That's like one of the rules. But I have constant recurring dreams of like they made an exception and they let me back in. And it's always either they like welcome me with open arms or like the school made an exception and I get to go back in, but like they don't really want me there.
No.
It's always one or the other. I don't know. Okay. It's very interesting. But about an interesting thing about dream catchers, when we were kids, we learned about sort of the Native American lore of like what a dream catcher is and all of that, and I had like horrible nightmares, and my sister and I, we like went to some camp or something, and they were talking about dream catchers. I don't remember the whole how it came about, but my sister was like, oh, I'll make you one. And my mom was sort of like, how are you gonna do that? It's not like we have like, you know, flexible wood and all. Like, it's not like we're craftsmen, like what are you talking about? And
that's
so
a nice thought.
My sister literally just drew me, like I can remember it so vividly in my mind, drew like with marker, like just on a piece of, you know, 8x11 printer paper, and hung it above my bed. And I don't know if this is just my childish imagination or if this actually happened, I don't really know, but I swear that like the little beads in the drawings would move sometimes. And when that was above my bed, I never had a nightmare. And so like dream catchers have always been like interesting.
I totally grew up with dream catchers too. Like I had bad dreams as a kid too, and my mom gave me one. And I think it is something about just thinking, okay, this is gonna help, that
thoughts
completely makes it work.
Just secreted that.
Yes, just secreted that. Yeah.
Good stuff.
Oh man.
This was now what really can cool.
So obviously you guys have some live shows coming up. Bummed we're gonna be here because I read
we'll
about
get,
it.
Yeah,
I like you know I've been like we've been digging your music for a while now. So I was like, oh, like a couple months ago, that's awesome. And then I'm like, oh, I'm gonna be in California. So hopefully we're on the same coast in a performance.
You're so sweet.
But like, what can fans expect from your live performances?
Well, we finally get to perform everything on the EP now.
Yeah.
Everything except for we're choosing between. There's one song that we might have to sub out on the EP because we're dealing with track stuff, but. Mm. You're gonna hear you're gonna hear all of our originals, and then a bunch of covers too.
Cool.
At this point, right now, you know, the Girl in the Dreamcatcher is a very ambitious endeavor, and we have nothing but you know positive things to say about it and positive things to feel about it. It's been so wonderful, but it is very ambitious, especially considering we're both actors.
Yeah.
And so you know, it's hard to really be able to like. Nail it down in the way that we want it to. So right now our live shows are very modest, you know.
It's us
and a guitar and an occasional track in the background. So
there is something very special. It's very intimate.
And while I obviously we share 100% of our music with our fans, and it's very about the fans, the you know, intricate. That's a recurring dream that I just can't say the word intricate. That sort of nature of how our performances are right now make it really special for us.
Yeah.
Like sharing that moment together and not having, you know, a bunch of, you know, band members on stage, which is sort of the next step, or not being too big, like just sort of like looking each other in the eyes and like sharing the music between the two of us and a guitar. It's like so overwhelmingly romantic.
And I think that's what they want to see, too. You know?
Yeah, like, well, it's cool to share that with them,
yes,
too.
Yes, right. Of course.
So here's my question, because it just made me think of a question, and I promise it's just one question, not
no,
seven
we love
questions wrapped in one. Like,
we hate
we'll,
to
we'll,
talk.
We'll, you've asked us, like, two
talk.
Questions, and we've turned it into a 45-minute endeavor.
All right, so let's go. So if you guys were to do, like, a remake of a classic film, like a movie from the 90s or 70s or whatever it might be, and so you're gonna play two like iconic love interests, or just two like characters from movie that you loved growing up. Who is it gonna be, and what movie is it gonna be?
Okay. Can I do I have to do a movie, or can I do
can
something
be
similar?
Can be anything.
Okay, because I would love to do Pushing Daisies the musical on Broadway with you.
Ooh.
You don't understand me. He won't watch Doctor Who, and he won't watch Pushing Daisies. And
it's
basically,
really
it's the one thing stopping me from ever truly falling in love with him.
That's a horrible joke.
Yeah.
And you make it in a lot of interviews. Like, you like are very like publicly outward about like, I really don't want to marry you.
That's so funny.
Really funny.
All right, how about you?
I don't really want to work
about,
with her
like, like 16 Candles or something like that.
Okay. Well, okay, so I have to be honest, I've never actually seen the movie, so I don't know if I'm being real about this, and maybe it's not necessarily this movie, but just sort of like the idea of it, but like a Mr. and Mrs. Smith kind of thing.
Ooh,
like,
so
like
yeah.
Danger, like
yes.
Enemies, but not enemies. Like,
I mean, I would never want to redo Casablanca because that's like a sin, but like something like that,
right?
Really, like old.
I was thinking like Rebel Without a Cause, or even like
Great Gatsby. Like I love the idea of like yearning for each other but actually not getting together.
Right.
That'd be an interesting.
Well, that's what I found interesting about
experience.
The music video you guys released is at first you're not
right.
together. And
Princess
I was like,
Luke Bender.
I was like, what? Wait, stop. So that was really true.
Or
like that
Happy
spin.
Gilmore. You could be Happy Gilmore and you could
We could do a lot.
There's
also a lot of like I used to own this Marilyn Monroe collection when
really?
I was younger of like her lesser known films.
Mm. Oh, cool.
Because she did a lot.
Oh,
and
yeah,
like
yeah.
only the main ones are
Marilyn
really
Monroe.
Ever.
No, she hardly was.
She was like tiny little,
who is that?
Little baby. But there's a bunch of stuff from social media star Marilyn Monroe.
Her Instagram would be popping though.
Yeah.
Oh, it would.
Taste of Marilyn.
Oh, yeah.
Instead of Meryl Streep. Okay. Anyway, but I would really love to do some of like the lesser known Marilyn classics.
Oh, yeah,
movies.
That'd be really cool.
Yes. Yeah.
I know that we're running low on time, so I guess.
Yeah, are you guys still there?
Yeah.
He's like, anyway.
There are only two people watching.
So I guess like last, you know, obviously YSB Now, it stands for You're So Beautiful Now. It was funny, we were on a red carpet like last week and we did the whole interview and then we're like, oh, can you look at the camera and say You're So Beautiful Now? And the girl was like, oh, that's really cool. Cause yeah. like the mic said YSB Now. But yeah, so basically, you know, yeah. our whole message and inspiration is really just like wanting to spread that love and make sure everyone knows that they're so beautiful now, not when you get your braces off, not when you fit into those jeans, but right now.
I get it.
So if you guys want to just speak to camera, speak to your fans and everybody out there listening, and just say, you know, why you're so beautiful now and don't get caught up and love yourself and all that good stuff.
This is what we live for.
Yes.
You are so beautiful right now. I mean, this is the kind of stuff that I love that you said that because we're like so on your vibe. You are so beautiful right now. There's nothing that you could do that wouldn't be good enough, that wouldn't be right. Everything happens for a reason. You're here for a reason. You are the way you are for a reason. Like, life's events and you and how those all relate to each other, those are all for a reason. Like, you can't, I mean, obviously, like, you know, don't commit any crimes, but like, you can do no wrong. You are good enough, no matter what. And not just in looks, not just in actions, but in everything that you are as your own individual entity in the world, as something that could never be replaced or replicated. Like, you are perfect.
Well, and up in keeping with the theme of what we were just talking about, I completely believe in manifestation. I completely believe in secreting things. And so if you subscribe to that belief, if you subscribe to the belief of the things that I think become my reality, the things that I believe in become my surroundings, what's stopping you?
Yeah.
Why not believe right now that you are good enough, that you are pretty enough, that you are smart enough, that you can do the things that you want to do? There is nothing stopping you from believing that right now and never forgetting it. So why not start? Right now, you are so beautiful.
Yes! All right. Don't miss the new EP, and yes. then
should we take them out?
If you
want to
just do a little quick, you know, don't miss the EP. Is it July 29th?
Yes.
July 29th.
Oh, see, yeah. I knew it, but I didn't want to mix it up. So, guys, the new EP, July 29th. Gotta hear it. Gotta listen to it. Gotta pre-order on iTunes.
Gotta.
Monster and Cry Wolf. Those two songs. Keep an eye out for those ones in particular, or an ear out. On the count of three, let's take them out and say, "You're so beautiful now."
One, two, three.
You're so beautiful now.